to bruise and leave behind.
All alone in space and time, there's nothing here but what hangers mine. Something borrowed, something blue.
Every me and every you.
Every me and every you. Every me and every you. Every me and every you. Every me and every you.
Welcome back to Central Coast Radio. You are listening to Subculture, and that was Every You, Every Me. And it was a very, very special version of the song because it was actually the Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical cast, that was singing it. And now that's what we are actually going to talk about, because joining me here in the studio right now is Lee. Welcome back, Lee.
Thanks for having me.
And yes, we're going to take a look at Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical, which is on in Melbourne right now for anybody that's thinking about heading down that way or is living in that area. This production of Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical, started in Melbourne. It went to Sydney. It's been to the Gold Coast. I think it's been across to Perth. It has done the lap of Australia, and people are loving it so much that it is now doing an encore season back in Melbourne. Lee, you've seen this a number of times, so have I. What do you think of Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical, which is based on the 90s film Cruel Intentions?
Well, I think you have to say that the 90s music is the best part of this musical, in the fact that the vocalists have amazing harmonies. They have really great 90s music, and it really tells the story.
Now, I am going to go on a very, very deep ledge here, because I am going to say that the people who cast this got this 100% right. Kirby Burgess plays Catherine Merdeville, who, of course, is the Sarah Michelle Gellar part from the original movie. Drew Weston plays Sebastian Velmont, which is the Ryan Philippe part from the original movie. And Kelsey Hogg plays Annette Hargrave, who was the Reese Witherspoon character in the original movie. Now, I'm going to say that Kirby, Drew, and Kelsey are the best things in Australian theatre at the moment. Their work on this production is just absolutely amazing. We hear that word triple threat so many times, but for these three, it's the only way that you can describe it, because in this show, they sing, they dance, and they actually have to act. This is not one of those musicals where the actors can drop their guard and just rest on their singing. There's some pretty intense scenes throughout this film. There's some very sensual scenes throughout this theatre production. What did you think of that performance, considering that they had to bring so much into those roles?
Yeah, there is a lot in these roles. Now, I will say that this production is not for those who get offended easily.
No.
It is definitely for adults. It is not for kids or teenagers. It is certainly an adult production. And the storylines are sexualized. I guess within the storyline, there's a moral storylines. It's a dark story.
It is
not a nice, lovely story. Now, not to say that there's not lovely characters within the storyline. However, most of the story is about taking advantage of people, revenge, and really it's about a game, if you think about it. And so these actors have to bring a lot to the story, and as they're singing as well, the emotion of their characters has to really come through, as well as when they're talking on stage. The other thing is the accents, of course. They have to get the accents right.
The New York accent.
The New York accent. And I guess you can really see the difference when the actor whose real name is Drew Weston, who plays Sebastian Velmont, he speaks to the audience at the end in his Aussie accent. And for a moment, you're like, hang on, what just happened? That doesn't sound like him. And you realize how well he has done to put on that New York accent, and how different he sounds as an Aussie. So that just reminds you of how much effort is going into these characters, because you could not tell that he was putting it on.
Yeah, and his is not just a New York accent. I should be more specific. His is a Manhattan accent, which is even more broader than that kind of New York accent that we all know and love. The other thing, too, that I think a lot of people haven't realized with this production, a lot of people talk about the original film Cruel Intentions and Dangerous Liaisons, which, of course, Cruel Intentions was based on, but... for example, Kirby has to do more than what Michelle Pfeiffer and Sarah Michelle Gellar did in those roles because she has to sing the songs. Of course, back in the original Cruel Intentions movie, the Cruel Intentions movie wasn't a musical. It just had an iconic soundtrack with artists like Fatboy Slim, Placebo, and it was just one of those soundtracks that gave us so many classic songs. But these performers actually have to perform those tracks as well. And one of the things that makes this such a different performance is the rock band is actually on stage with them. There's times when some of the sets move and you actually see the rock band behind them, and that almost gives the feeling of rock musical, like a new sense, because it feels like a rock concert.
That's right. The other thing I liked about the storyline was, although the main storyline is really about Sebastian and his stepsister, Catherine, there are storylines throughout it of other characters that really shine through. So there's almost like mini stories within the big story. And we get to see Cecile and her character develop and how she might be taken advantage of at times. And her performance, she's such a quirky character.
Yeah.
And she has the audience laughing and just having fun throughout. Now, Catherine's character, her voice is powerful. She just has the whole place like watching her in awe when she performs some of the rock music. Now, within this, there is rock music and also pop. So it's not just one sort of music. You see Annette's character and, the brilliance in her performance, because she's a lovely character, I guess. And but then she has to sing powerful songs.
Yeah, that's one of the things I was going to say I love about the music in this, because you have, of course, Placebo, The Verve, which are the two classic songs from Cruel Intentions. But also what happens with this as well is that Catherine delivers these powerful songs that many people would know by Meredith Brooks, Only Happy When It Rains by Garbage. Meanwhile, Kelsey Halls, who's playing Annette, she's delivering these heartfelt songs like Foolish Games by Jewel. Also, Drew Weston has to do one of those as well with Colorblind, one of my favorite songs off the original soundtrack. But apart from the songs, I also wanted to talk about the stage. Because one of the things that's been happening in theatre in Australia over the last couple of years, we call it the Harry Potter effect. When Harry Potter, the Cursed Child, came to Australia, it did things on stage that had never been done before. And one of the big fears was that after that, nothing was ever going to wow audiences again stage-wise. Luckily, with Cruel Intentions, they have an absolutely amazing set. The set literally comes to life. There's people constantly moving things on set as it goes from Catherine and Sebastian's Manhattan mansion through to Sebastian's aunt's house. Like, people remember the pool scene, we see that. There's outside shots supposedly of like out on the street. There's stuff at the school. They do it so amazingly well with such a minimal kind of set. There's also Sebastian's handwriting from his journal appears on the wall a lot during it as well. And I've been told if you actually read that when you're in the cinema, you actually get some interesting little insights to what's going on as well. So what did you think of the staging of this production?
Yeah, it was magnificent, actually. I enjoyed it a lot. I guess the work that's gone into it is just incredible. I personally love the way you see the handwriting come up on the wall. And when you first arrive, you can see part of the diary, just as the backdrop for while you're waiting. The other thing I loved about this, which not all productions do, is they create the atmosphere basically as soon as you get there. They've got the 90s music in the foyer, they're not all popular 90s music songs when you arrive, but as the time draws closer, when you go and you sit in your seat and the time is drawing close to the production starting, you start to get the bigger hits, 90s music, and already people are singing along and just anticipating and waiting for the production to start. What I also noticed was throughout the production, audience members were singing along. I was one of those people, but I did do it quietly to myself and try not to annoy the person next to me. But there were times when people were singing out loud together with the actors because of that atmosphere that was created. So in intermission, I also noticed people were singing along to those songs, standing and bopping around, just standing where their seats were and bopping around, waiting for the second half to begin. So I think they do very well. The DJ did very well as well. So while there's a live band, there's also a DJ for the lead up to the production starting and the intermission.
Yeah, everybody kind of comes in and sits down and they hear the music and you can see them going, oh, it's Janet Jackson, am I allowed to sing along? Everybody, though, starts to sing along when they play Backstreet Boys, Backstreet's Back. I've noticed every time I've gone to see it, that's the song where people go, nah, I can't just sit here anymore. I've got to sing along to this. Now, we are going to wrap up our review of Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical, because coming up after another track from the musical, we're actually going to have Kelsey Hall, who plays Annette Hargrove, chatting to us about her role in Cruel Intentions, and that's a pretty interesting interview that I think you're all going to love out there. So to wrap up, Lee, what's your recommendation for people? Should they go along and see Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical?
Yes, you should. However, with that caveat of if you get offended easily or you're not used to kind of immoral storylines or storylines of revenge, then that's just a caution. I'm not saying don't see it, but you need to be prepared that that's what it is. But if you love 90s music, if you have seen the original movie, if you love these sorts of storylines, this is definitely for you.
Definitely. This is, I think, one of my favorite musicals that I have ever seen. I loved this movie when I first saw it when I was a teenager, so much so that I've got a cardboard cutout of the cast in my office. I've always had a copy of the soundtrack and always made sure that I've had a copy of the DVD, and seeing it come to life as a musical has just been absolutely amazing. I've been along and seen it so many times already, and I'm sure I'm going to go and see it a couple of times again. That's just how much I love it. So I would highly recommend it for anybody who grew up on this kind of music. You are going to absolutely love this, and you'll be blown away by the three leads who do such an amazing job. Talking of those leads, as I said, we are going to play another track right now from the cast. We're going to play Bittersweet Symphony, which, of course, most people will know via The Verve, but this is actually by the cast. And after that, we are going to talk to Kelsey Hall about her role of Annette Hargrove in Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical. You're listening to Subculture on Central Coast Radio, and here is the cast of Cruel Intentions, the 90s musical, with Bittersweet Symphony.
True to ourselves and resist the temptations of peer pressure. A student body president, I've tried to set an example in myself. Unfortunately, the one person I could not reach out to in time was my stepbrother, Sebastian. I know he's looking down on us today, and
he wants me to say Catherine, I'm sorry.
She's a liar.
Because it's a bittersweet symphony, this life. Try to make ends meet, you're a slave to money, then you die.
I'll take you down.
Yeah.
chains, but I'm here in my mold. I am here in my mold.
Ends me, try to find some money, then you die. I'll take you down the only road I've ever been down. You know the one that takes you to the places where all the things meet, yeah.
I want to start off by saying how excited we are about Cruel Intentions coming back to Melbourne. This was a show that I saw on opening night, and then I had so many friends who wanted to go and see it. I think I went back about 4 or 5 times to see it. So congratulations on making such an impact on Melbourne and coming back to Melbourne.
Oh my goodness, thank you so much, and thank you for all your support.
No problem at all. Cassie, tell us a little bit about what it was like for you when you first found out that you were going to be in Cruel Intentions, the musical, especially playing the role of Annette.
It was crazy. I mean, the audition process was so fun that I just assumed I wouldn't book the job. It consisted of a few self-tapes and then a few in-person auditions. This was one of the first shows that I auditioned for since graduating from university. And, you know, it can be daunting, but the creative team was so warm and welcoming to everyone. And I honestly just had the best time. We rehearsed the show in 2 weeks, which is kind of unheard of. Especially because this is an Australian premiere, we were allowed to kind of explore what the show would look like for an Australian audience. So we did have a really close relationship with the writer and director of the film, Roger, and also Jordan and Lindsay too. But we were able to kind of manipulate this to make sense for Australian audiences, which I thought was awesome. And as you said, you've seen the show, and the scale of the show is really huge with everything that we're putting on, you know, the set, the lighting, and the design. So it took us a little while, but we are up and running, and it has been incredible.
Exactly. I was going to say, you just blew me away when you said that you rehearsed it in 2 weeks, because that the set movement alone is fantastic during this show. What was that like, learning all of that within 2 weeks? And like you said, this being one of your first professional theatre productions as well.
It was a time. It was 2 weeks. Everything moved very quickly, but I still felt like I had enough time to get a grasp on my character and for everyone else to do the same and for us to really explore every avenue of what the show could be.
Now that leads into my next question as well. How much about the character of Annette did you know before you went for that audition? Had you ever seen the film Cruel Intentions, or was it all fresh for you?
I'll tell you a little secret. I'm not actually born in the 90s, so I'm a 2000s baby.
Yeah.
So I didn't know much about Cruel Intentions except for the really iconic moments that, you know, you can even see on Instagram now. So, like, the iconic kiss and the funny faces scene. I didn't know too much about Cruel Intentions. But, you know, I'm feeling the shoes of Reese Witherspoon, and I'm not sure if that's even possible. They're certainly big shoes to fill, but I hope that I can kind of capture some of the essence of what Reese brought to this role. as part of the pre-work and the activities that we did in the rehearsal room under the direction of Alistair Smith, I've kind of gone back and studied Reese's perception of who Annette is, especially into comparison of the way that Michelle Pfeiffer played it in Dangerous Liaisons. But also, you know, Annette was one of Reese Witherspoon's first leading roles, and it's one of my first leading roles. It is my first leading role. So it's been a privilege to study Reese, but also to kind of bring myself to the stage. You know, although we are using the same material from the movie, we are really looking at it through a 2023 lens.
Yeah.
So it allows each character to understand, each actor to understand their character and really make it their own by, you know, using the knowledge and the understandings we have today. I think, you know, for me personally, there are definitely a few qualities of Annette Hargrove that I see myself. You know, ironically, both of my parents are principals of high school, so that's already an understanding there. But it's been such a joy to expand and grow with her over this year and a bit. And, yeah, really delve into how she thinks and how she acts.
And you've taken the role right around Australia as well. Have you felt that Annette's kind of evolved during that journey as well? Like, do you feel that the character kind of grows every night that you're on the stage?
100%. I booked this job when I was 21. I'm now 22, about to turn 23. So I've sat with this character for a while. So, you know, even into this new version of the tour, I've really come back to her and, yeah, delved deeper into how she thinks and how she moves and how she holds herself and how she responds to certain characters and situations. So, yeah, as I said, it's been such a privilege to be able to have her for such a long time and to continue to grow and evolve as an actor and as a character.
Now, do you think not knowing about the film and not having seen it actually helped you with the role? Because I remember I spoke to Kirby when it first came to Melbourne, and she said that one of the things that she found difficult about going into the role of Catherine was that she had grown up kind of watching the film and was kind of scared to take on Sarah Michelle Gellar's role. Do you think not having seen the film actually helped some of those nerves for you?
Oh, I don't know if you'll ever not feel nervous when you're taking on such an iconic character and playing a role made iconic by Reese Witherspoon. I don't know if those nerves will ever go away. I don't know if that helped or hindered me. But yeah, as I said, I'm very grateful that I get to do this every night and get to play with such an incredible cast.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned before about the iconic scenes from the film, but of course the soundtrack was very iconic as well. It gave us some amazing tracks. It introduced, I think, Aussies to bands like Placebo and bands like that that previously hadn't really had a stranglehold on the Australian market. Music plays such a big part of the stage production as well. Tell us a little bit about what it was like for you getting to sing some of those iconic tracks for the first time when you first stepped out onto the stage as well.
Yeah, so the show features a 90s soundtrack of 21 iconic songs, including Bittersweet Symphony, Every You, Every Me, Bye Bye Bye. It really is just banger after banger. I think there's a beautiful mix of grunge that is clearly evident in the 90s, but there's also an element that I like to call bubblegum pop. And also, it's not just a jukebox musical. Each song is kind of really written into the story. It either elevates the comedy and it enhances the emotion or the narrative. So everything kind of comes back to the story. And yeah, as you said, these songs have such a special place in my heart, and I've been singing them since I've been singing. So it's the best when I get to stand on stage and sing these songs and the audience laughs or, you know, they're singing along with me. It's something that I've never experienced in a theatre.
Yep.
And that is insane to me. Also, our band is led by Daniel Puppy, and our band is actually on stage with us, which really lifts the energy of the entire show. It makes moments more intimate and others. It kind of feels like you're at a rock concert, which,
yeah,
again, is something that I've never really experienced in theatre either.
Now, one song that people don't sing along to, I know, is one of yours, Foolish Games, because that track, when you perform it, it gives people goosebumps. So every time I've gone along with friends, they've walked away saying that that was one of the highlights of the show. You put so much emotion into that song. What is it like for you on stage singing that track? Because it feels like you're feeling every single word of that track.
That is so kind. Thank you so much. I do. I really do. I feel everything that Annette is feeling in that moment, and it is my favorite number to sing on stage. I can really just let everything out. And, yeah, it's such a pivotal moment for her in the show, and it feels – I'm so passionate about that moment. But, yeah, thank you so much for those kind words. That's so – beautiful and touching that, you know, it affects people the way that it affects me. I think that's kind of my goal as an artist, and to hear that, you know, some people are going home and feeling those types of feelings, it is amazing.
Yeah. Like I said as well, like, this show's gone right around Australia now as well. How have you found that you've bonded with the rest of the cast? Because that's kind of rare these days. Like, quite often, you'll have massive cast changes if a musical does go interstate. What's that been like with only very, very small cast changes and that core group being together for this production?
Yeah, so we have an all-Australian cast of Triple Threat talent in addition to also our multi-Green Room award-winning creative team. So for me, like, what more could I ask for in the way of role models in this industry when I get to go on stage and work with Kirby Burgess and Drew Weston and Finn Balling and everyone else in the cast? It has been such a pinch-me moment. I remember watching Kirby in Wedding Singer, and I remember I've got Drew on my Spotify. Like, I was such a fangirl when I met both of them. They've been so generous and supportive, and I love sharing the stage with them. This cast really does inspire me to give my absolute all. And we are so close. You know, as I said, there's 14 of us. Yeah, so we are really close, which is great because it makes every relationship even deeper. And, yeah, everything just feels, it's so lovely. I'm so blessed.
Now, I have to ask, what was that moment like? As you said, you were such big fans of them before you got this role. What was that like the first day you walked into rehearsal and they were all there?
Yeah, so the first time I met Drew and Kirby was we were doing a media photo shoot at the Athenaeum Theatre. And I remember Kirby was on stage in her red wig and Drew was standing next to her in his turtleneck. And I walked up to the dressing room and I sat down and they were doing my makeup. And I turned to the makeup artist and I just said, "What is my life right now?" It was so insane. As I said, I have watched them and their careers, and to be able to work alongside them and to call them my friends and, you know, to text them and go to breakfast with them, it's still so crazy to me. And I'm so grateful that I get to work with them and share these moments with them. The rehearsal room meeting everyone, it was such a warm and exciting buzz in the room. Day of rehearsals, we knew we had a lot of work to do. We only had 2 weeks to get this up and running, but it was, yeah, the buzz and that feeling, the fire in your tummy to kind of get everything done and working with such professionals, it's been amazing.
We've talked a little bit about how this was your first professional production. What advice would you give to young actors and actresses out there who maybe in high school at the moment or maybe going through performing arts school? What would your advice be to them now that you've got into a professional production?
Oh, that is such a tough question. I would say, I think everything comes down to just trusting yourself and your craft and your ability to navigate everything that you face in this world. I think that would be my advice. Just trust yourself and, yeah, everything that is meant to be is meant to be. And, go through every door feeling super positive and, take every opportunity that you can. Everything, you know, small, big, everything is a learning opportunity. That would be my advice at the moment. Hopefully awesome. You can give me a call after a couple more shows and my advice might be totally different.
That is amazing advice. And Kelsey, I know we're running out of time very, very quickly. So just to finish off, what would you like to say to all the people here in Melbourne before they go and grab tickets to come and see this amazing show once again?
I think I would say Cruel Intentions, it's a fun, nostalgic trip. It's the ultimate 90s throwback experience that I think will have audiences laughing, singing, and dancing in the aisles, whether you are into grunge, baggy pants, or bubblegum pop and butterfly clips. I think this show has you covered. And especially after a turbulent last few years with the impact of the pandemic and COVID-19, I think this show is what everyone needs. It's an enjoyable, cheeky, fun night at the theatre.